The following speech was delivered at the Phoenix Society Annual World Burn Congress, held October 5, 2007, at the Vancouver, British Columbia Weston Bayshore Hotel. Here is keynote speaker George Pessotti.
It's been a long-time supporter of the Phoenix Society. I consider him one of the people that has carried our vision and our heart for many years. And it's a privilege to have him speak to us today. I think you'll find his humor and his candor and his just craziness a lot of fun. He's touched many people. And I don't think I've laughed harder than when I sit with George sometimes. And it's one of those that the next day, your sides are still sore. So we love you, and I welcome George to the stage.
Bonjour.
Break a leg.
I'm wired.
Oh, he's on wire.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
As they say in Canada, bienvenue. Today's a very special day for me. My mother was born in New Brunswick, Canada. She was one of nine children. It was the 1920s. At age 14, her family could not afford to feed her or her sister. My mother was put on a coal train from Moncton, New Brunswick, to the South Station in Boston, Massachusetts. She always talked about that train ride, the adversity that she faced in her life. And I often wondered about what it was like for a 14-year-old girl who couldn't speak a word of English to be on the coal train with men staring at her for 2 days on the train ride. She sat on her suitcase in the South Station waiting for her uncle to pick her up. He was 2 hours late. She was sobbing on her suitcase. See, sometimes in life, through adversity, we are introduced to ourselves. My mom went to a home where she served as a nanny, cooked, cleaned, chambermaid, learned all of the qualities that were important in becoming a good mother. And those qualities, many of them, were transferred to me as a person. So I say sometimes, the first slide I have is a picture of the ocean. And if you look across the ocean, you'll notice that the sky meets the ocean. In the old days, if Christopher Columbus had looked at that slide, many people said it was the end of the world. If you would have gone on a boat, the world was flat, not round. You would have fallen off the ocean. But Christopher Columbus set out on his mission because he believed that there was something beyond those waters. So I think through adversity in life, we are introduced to ourselves. Statesman Nelson Mandela, after he was released from prison, said something that I never forgot. He said, "Man can never extinguish the flame of hope." After spending many years in his prison cell, he never lost faith in his people or his cause or his mission. I have an acronym for HOPE that I've developed over the years. I think the letter H stands for help, the O stands for others, and the P stands for people, and the E stands for excel. Help other people excel. I hope I can do that today. I've spent 28 years of my life since my burn injury working, trying to help, uplift, and inspire others affected by the devastation of a burn injury. My story begins on May 12, 1979. I was doing a little home repair. I had torn some carpet up from the inlaid in the hallway. My dad, who was a mechanic, I'd seen him use gasoline to clean dirty bolts and parts in carburetors. I knew that gas was a good grease cutter. There were two pesky blotches of glue which remained near the threshold of the door. I put on a pair of gloves, got a can of gas, poured a little gas on the rag, and wiped those two blotches of glue. Little did I know that gas fumes are heavier than air. As the rag that was laying on top of the can, the fumes kept emanating from the rag and from the can. Being heavier than air, it was a cold, cool May day. The fumes traveled a great distance down a hallway. They came in contact with the pilot light on the gas stove. There was a tremendous explosion, equivalent to 10 sticks of dynamite. I thank God that I was not knocked unconscious. I ran from my home out into the street and rolled on the ground. This was my home at 38 Plain Road in Westford, Mass. This is the kitchen area. I was very lucky to get out of this explosion. Bill McMillan was an EMT. We talk about fire service personnel. Bill McMillan was visiting my neighbor. He heard the explosion and he ran to the scene. He worked as a magician. He immediately got the garden hose and watered down my face, which was second degree burns. He cooled my body. He took off my wedding ring because my fingers started to swell. He took off my watch. My gold chain had heated up to 1,500 degrees. My polyester socks had melted to my lower legs. He pulled them off, preventing surgical removal at a later date. He cut a piece of gauze and had me suck on the wet, cooling gauze because he didn't know if I had an inhalation burn where I would have suffocated. Bill McMillan was the man that saved my life that day, and I thank him every May 12th, which is my second birth date, for his heroic act that day. I learned that I had sustained second and third degree burns on over 85% of my body. In 1979, the techniques were a lot different then than they are today. In the old days, you had to withstand a lot more pain. Today, most people are put into a medically induced coma. At that time, I would go for daily Hubbard tankings where they'd soak my body in chlorine-based water, soaking the bandages to make it easier for the nursing staff to do the debridement. Your body shaked uncontrollably because your nerve endings are exposed to the air. It was a very painful journey. Thank God for morphine because I'd find myself looking forward to those shots every 4 hours. I spent 70 days in the intensive care at Brigham and Women's in Boston. That's the hospital that saved my life. When I first met Dr. Nicholas O'Connor, he came in, he said, young man, he says, you've sustained second and third degree burns on over 85% of your body. There's probably a one chance in 10 that you'll survive. I said to him, those might be your odds, but they're not mine. Because I believe in life, if you have a good attitude in life, you can achieve some great altitudes in life. So I kept my sense of humor through my recovery. I worked consuming 10,000 calories a day of fraps, doing my sit-ups, working around the unit. There was a lot going on. Several times I was close to death. After discharge from the hospital, the next journey began. While I was in the hospital, my first wife visited me every day, but I noticed towards the end she didn't come and visit once during the last 10 days. It was a very emotional time for me, and my mind started to wander, wondering whether the troubled marriage would survive. I remember my two little boys coming in to visit me in the burn unit. They were 3 and 5 years old at the time. My five-year-old with his gloves and his cap and his gown and his little slippers on. The first time he looked at me, he said, Daddy, you look like a monster. Never forget those words. As we approached coming home from the hospital, my son Stephen said, Dad, when you come home, are you coming home forever? I looked him straight in the face and said, Son, Dad's coming home forever. Little did I know that 30 days after I returned home from the hospital, I left home. The marriage fell apart. The bonds were not strong enough. My ex had an alcohol problem. She was more concerned with her drinking than she was with caring for me. I can remember days, one day, I couldn't do my dressing changes. I couldn't do my lanolin rubs. So somehow I got into the bathtub and ran the water, and I sat there for 15 minutes soaking. I was so weak, I couldn't stand up. I couldn't get out of the tub. I called out, there was no one there to help me. Those are painful days, right? Tough times. But I also remember some good things. There was one day when I was in the mobile home while our home was being rebuilt, there was a knock on the door, and a little four-year-old boy with his father came in, and his father said, go ahead, say what you want to say to the man. And he came over to me, he says, my daddy told me about the fire at your house and how your boys had lost all of their toys in the fire. So I have an extra toy, and I brought that with me today for your boys. See, acts of kindness, the world is full of them. Sometimes we have to look under rocks to find the kindness. In this group, there's kindness throughout the room, throughout the convention. Okay? That was my story. It was a painful one, and I tend not to focus on the story. But what I'll talk about a little bit later is Man came in to give me hope. Today we're going to talk about renewing. Many of you are in the recovery stage. But today let's try and renew, and hopefully some of the things that I say will help you return to your community. But when I was in the hospital, little did I know that this was a life-changing event. The burn technician said, there's a burn survivor here that would like to meet you. Would you like to meet him? Having a good attitude, being kind of open, I said, sure, I'd love to meet him. Well, in walks the door. I had never met another burn survivor. Not only hadn't I met somebody who was burned, I had never met anybody who was facially disfigured. As the man approached my bed, I looked at him and my jaw, much like the public, must have dropped. His face was horribly scarred. He had prosthetic ears. He had a patch on one eye. One eye was leaking. His nose had been rebuilt. He had fingers missing on each hand. He put out his hand. He said, hi. He says, I'm Alan Breslaw. I'm a burn survivor. I survived a plane crash in 1963. I spent 4.5 years in the hospital, and I've had 57 operations on my face. How are you doing today? How are you doing? How are you doing? How are you doing? Alan pointed, I overlooked, I decided out of my speech to take out the fact that his wig was crooked, but I will add that you know, the part on his wig was kind of going at a 45 degree angle, and I don't know what direction. Alan says his head was crooked, not the wig. But what I found out, little did I realize then at a young man, I was 31 years of age when I was burned, but as I found myself listening to Alan's story, he told me that the doctors told him he would never play the piano again, and he told me how he now was able to play the piano. He told me he loved to play tennis, and the doctors told him that he wouldn't be able to play tennis, and Alan explained to me how he made a special Velcro strip to hold the racket to his hand. He told me how he had started a wonderful support organization called the Phoenix Society, and he was running it out of his home in Allentown, Pennsylvania. So I found myself listening to what the man had to say, and there was a revelation. I found that as he talked, his scars disappeared. And I say to each and every one of you with visible or facial disfigurement, if you can strike up a conversation and tell your story in a loving, caring, compassionate manner, that the public will respond to your story, story of courage. I didn't see Alan's scars anymore. I found myself listening what the man had to offer on the inside. I'd like to talk a little bit about my book called Reason for Living. After discharge from the hospital, it was a very traumatic time. My marriage fell apart. I was sleeping on friends' couches, sleeping in sleazy motels. Didn't have a lot of direction. I was out of work. I was practically bankrupt. But my secretary at the time, Joanne, had come to visit me. And she knew how terrible things were at home. I was living alone on a friend's couch. So she'd call and say, gee, let's toss a coin to see who does the bandage changes today. Let's see who will do the lanolin rubs, because I couldn't reach parts of my body. I walked around a lot like a monster in my arms. I couldn't shave. So every day for a year, Joanne would drive from the South Shore of Massachusetts, Marshfield, Mass., to my friend's apartment in Boston. Never complaining, doing the dressing changes, the lanolin rubs. We'd talk. We became friends. We found that we had a lot to offer. She always told me she loved my sense of humor. She loved the fact that I was dedicated to my children. She loved that I was hardworking, that I was motivated, that I had a good attitude. Those were the things she fell in love with. We married 2 years later, and I'm proud to say we celebrated our 25th anniversary this past January. Because every burn survivor that's gone through a traumatic experience, one of your worries is, will somebody love me despite my scars? And I say to you, if you become a better person on the inside, I've read, sorry to say, many of the women's magazines on what men love in a woman, what men love in a man. Well, isn't it interesting that good looks is about number 8 on the list of things that women love in men? When you read those, they say they love sense of humor. They love that he's a good communicator, that he talks, that he's faithful, that he's hardworking. Those are the things people fall in love with. They've got nothing to do with the wrappings of the package, but to the contents of the package. So work hard on becoming a better person on the inside. When I tried to figure out my reason for living and my purpose for living, I decided to do a self-inventory, trying to figure out who I was, where was I going, why was I the person that I was then and the person that I am today. And I did an inventory of my mom and dad, who were great mentors to me. They worked hard through the Depression raising four children. We didn't have a lot of money, but we never went without love and food and home cooking. Right? My mom had a great sense of family. She was always gathering her children for barbecues and 4th of July and Mother's Day and Father's Day and christenings, all of those things today that are so important are the family values. My dad loved sports. He'd hit ground balls to us out on the front lawn, and he'd hit them pretty hard. And he'd say, don't be a sissy. Don't get out of the way of that line drive. How are you ever going to be good? Don't duck. Put your glove up. That was my dad. I get my competitive nature of sports from my dad. And the Red Sox are probably going to win today. I think they are. Now, if anybody's having trouble understanding me, I am from Boston, and we talk a little funny. We do not pronounce R's, and we do not pronounce I-N-G. So when I say car, that means car, C-A-R. Just think of it as car, C-A-H. Well, I went to Harvard. And I parked the car in the yard, and I had a cup of chowder the other day, and Bobby loves my sneakers. See, there's no R's. Well, I went to a wedding the other day. There's no I-N-G. I went to a wedding. But it's America. We all talk a little different. Cooking, my mom was a great cook. And all of the Pessotti kids are great cooks because we'd help my mom around the kitchen. And I'm proud to say that I love cooking. My mom was a gardener. She always had a couple of rows of corn and beans going. She loved to garden, loved to plant flowers, always fresh cut roses on the table. My love of gardening today comes from my mom. So sometimes I say inventory. Look at the people that have affected you in your life. What values or traditions, you know, did you receive from them? Right? My dad was a funny, funny man. My sense of humor, I know I got from my dad. He was a funny guy, even till the end, where he battled Alzheimer's. And it was a very difficult time, but he never lost his sense of humor. But one day, I took him to the doctor for his annual physical. Now, my dad was born in 1922. He didn't care what he looked like, whether he had stains on his pants or whatever. So he goes in for his annual physical, and Dr. Schneeweis, he always made fun of people's names. Dr. Schneeweis comes in and says, could you drop your pants, Mr. Pessotti? We're going to do your rectal. So as my father dropped his pants, this was in the winter, he had a pair of 1953 Woolworth long underwear on. And as he bent over, there was a big hole in the ass. And I hate to say it was brown and crusty. So the doctor's over here, he's putting on his gloves, getting ready to do the exam, and I'm looking at this crime scene. It looked like you took the cover off of a septic tank, and I said, oh my God. So I turned to the doctor, I said, doctor, you might want a double glove. So as he turns, he comes over, my father's there with his forearms on the table, and the doctor turned to me, he said, now Mr. Pessotti, you're gonna feel a little pressure. And he says, it won't hurt. So in goes the finger. My father snaps his head to the doctor. And the doctor says, did I hurt you, Mr. Pessotti? Did I hurt you? And my father says, no. He says, I just wanted to make sure that was your finger. He says, you know, I've read a lot of those stories about what goes on in some of these doctor's offices. So I must say, I think I received my sense of humor from my father. There were these three drunks, and they were the best of friends. See, now that you have me going on humor, I could do a whole workshop on humor, but maybe I'll do that another year, but I have some more serious things to say. Well, these three drunks were drinking buddies every day for 40 years, and Charlie dropped dead suddenly one day. And so they were having the wake on a Friday night, and the two survivors said, gee, we should go down and pay our respects to old Charlie. You know, we were friends for 40 years. So they walked into the funeral home, and as they kneeled down at the casket, there's Charlie laying there. And one drunk turns to the other drunk, and he says, you know, he says, old Charlie looks pretty good, doesn't he? And the other drunk said, he oughta. He hasn't had a drink in 3 days. Little bit of humor. I was flying into an airport about 3 months ago, and there was construction on the runway. They were paving. And as the plane set the wheels down, there was a bump as the plane hit, and everybody kind of got alarmed. And the stewardess didn't even hesitate. She came on the PA system. She says, "You probably noticed there was a little construction going on out on the runway. They're paving the runway." So she says, "That big bang was not the pilot's fault. It was the asphalt." Pretty quick thinking. I kind of like that one. Now, my parents had a lot of good qualities, and like any relationship of people you meet in life, there are also bad qualities. I choose to put the negative qualities on what I call the right side of the ledger. My dad was a very critical person. He was stubborn. He was a poor listener. Him and my mom fought. He'd give her the silent treatment. It would be miserable around the house for 3-4 days till they had makeup sex. No, they didn't do that in those days. But until they made up, it was kind of miserable, you know, around the home. But I try and be aware of those negative qualities, because in life, it's not the good things that break up marriages, businesses, or relationships, is it? You never see someone divorced because he's too loving, or he communicates too well, or he's got a sense of humor. It's always, well, he's too critical, he's verbally abusive, right? He's this, he's that, she's this, she's that. It's the negative qualities that break things up in life. I have a little example that when I talk to some of the young folks, I call it my billboard theory. I tell them, you know, in life we all drive down the road, and they don't have too many billboards today because they're a thing of the past, but everybody knows what a billboard is. So as you drive by a billboard, maybe there's a sign flashing that says alcoholism might be an issue in a family. But when we're in love, we lead with our heart, not with our head, right? We all do that. Those are poor business decisions when you lead with your heart, not your head. I drove by that alcohol billboard in my first marriage. My first wife was in a car accident, and the man she loved died in that crash, and she was abusing marijuana and alcohol. I didn't think that would be a big deal in my marriage. I blew right by that billboard. I talk to young kids, they say, "Well, you know, he slapped me the other day." I mean, physical abuse is a problem. Verbal abuse is a problem. Pay attention to those billboards as you go through your life, because those are the things that will break up a marriage or a relationship. My dad had a great tenor's voice. There were two boys in the family, my brother Jack and myself, and Dad used to sing in minstrel shows. And he was approached, this is Dad as an Indian chief at age 35 in a minstrel show. But he decided not to travel with the Tommy Dorsey Orchestra. He decided that to stay home and rear his two boys and project his love, sense of family, and his faith was something that was more important than being away from home and chasing the almighty buck. My dad never recorded a song, but I heard him sing many times at weddings and anniversary parties. So today, this is gonna be a short clip from my dad singing "Love is a Many Splendid Thing" at my wedding in 1982. So I think my dad is here today. This is his first CD. There's a little bit of background noise because in 1982, the technology was not as good as it is today. Let me know after whether you think Dad had a good voice. One of the saddest days of my life was the day my mom died. She had two strokes within 10 days, spent the last 2.5 years of her life at a nursing home. It was a difficult time. For the mother that I loved, she couldn't eat, she couldn't talk, she couldn't walk. And at the funeral, a man came through the procession line, and I didn't know who he was. I knew most everybody at that funeral. So I introduced myself, and I said, "How do you know my mom?" He said, "Well," he said, "I'm the surveyor that surveyed a piece of land in Stowe next to their home." He said, "I came there one February day, and it was about minus 20 degrees chill factor. And I was setting my transit in the field, and my hands were freezing." He said, "Out of the corner of my eye, a little woman, all of 5 feet tall, from Capelet, New Brunswick, came out, and she said, 'It's awful cold today. When you get done, please come in. I've made a homemade chicken soup, and I'll have a fresh pot of coffee waiting for you.'" So I walked into the home, I knocked on the door, and your mom said, "Come in, sit right down." She gave me a hot, steaming bowl of chicken soup. She said, "I made these homemade rolls. Would you like one?" She even buttered it for him. "Would you like a cup of coffee?" "Yes." "Would you like another cup of coffee?" "Okay. I made a homemade pie. Would you like a piece with a little scoop of ice cream on it?" "Sure." He says, "I only met your mother once." He says, "But I'll never forget her. She treated me like a son." And he says, "And that's why I'm here today, to pay respect to your mom." As I've gone through my life, I've tried to emulate my mom because I think she was the queen of pay it forward. She was always doing these little acts of kindness. She'd go and she'd give you a couple of cookies when you leave. They didn't have a lot of money. They showed their love by giving you food or welcoming you into their home. I was in St. Louis at the World Burn Congress. I was coming to the hotel to do a talk, and as I stepped out, I thought I was looking pretty good in my three-piece suit, and a panhandler approached me. He says, "Hey man, can you spare a little change? I'm hungry." So I looked at him, I said, "You really hungry, or are you going to buy a drink?" "No, man," he says, I'm hungry." He says, "I don't think I've had a thing to eat in a week." So I looked across the street, and there was a Burger King on the corner. I tried to think of the image of me in a three-piece suit and him with his hair. He looked like Jim on Taxi. Remember Jim on Taxi? He had a plastic bag full of cans. So I says, "Come on." I says, "I'm buying. So you can have anything you want to eat." So here I go with my suit, and he's dragging his plastic bag into Burger King. This is what I call my $7.21 pay it forward story. "May I help you, sir?" "Yeah." "Anything he wants, I'm buying." "Would you like a double cheeseburger?" "Oh, yeah, man, I like a double cheeseburger." "How about a large fry?" "Do you have a Coke?" I said, "I can't remember last time I had a Coke." "Give him a Coke." "How about a little hot apple pie?" "Would you like a little hot apple pie?" They didn't have a scoop of ice cream at Burger King, but you get the point. So I sat down with the man, and the waitress said, $7.21. I gladly paid the $7.21, and I sat with him, and you know what? He was truly hungry. And I learned that he was a casualty of the Vietnam War. Tough era. Many people were judged back in those days. $7.21, sir. That's the best $7.21 I ever spent. Because the joy of helping another human being, you cannot put a price tag on that joy. It's not about the money. I've been to many funerals in my life, and I've never seen a suitcase on the top of a hearse. You might think you can take it with you, but you can't. So if you're not going to take it with you, I would encourage you to leave a bequest in your will to the Phoenix Society. Because you can't take it with you. Maybe you sign over some of your money from your life insurance policy. We can always use money in this organization. Put us in your estate plan, because you're not going to take it with you. About 10 years ago, I was in Ireland. My grandmother, my father's mother, was from Ireland. She was a great lady. She raised her family as a waitress. My dad's father died when he was 10 years old, left 5 children under the age of 10 in the Depression. And his mother and his aunt, who moved to Massachusetts from Ireland, they raised those 5 boys as waitresses. And I always knew how hard they worked. So that day after golf, we had 24 golfers. We were in Ireland. And we were thirsty. And we were there as a free trip. I was one of the top producers for this insurance company. And Mr. Grogan was paying the tab for all 24 golfers. Meals, hotel, lodging, airfare, drinks, you name it. So we walk into this little Irish pub, and there's 2 regulars sitting at the counter. And here's Maggie behind the counter. She's cleaning, waiting. "Hi, can I help you?" "Yeah, party of 24. party at 24. She's got like two regular customers. Well, she says, I'll help you. So she goes out back, she brings out, carries out a 4x8 sheet of plywood, she plops it down on top of the pool table, she's putting out a tablecloth, she's setting it, she's cooking burgers, fries, she's bringing drinks, she's busting her tail for these 24 golfers. So I think she reminded me of my grandmother, she was working hard. So I said, you know, I think everybody should have a day in life that they never that they'll never forget. So I said, I'm gonna take up a tip collection for Maggie. So I took my golf cap off and I went to each man. I said, we're going to take up a collection for Maggie. And anybody that puts less than $100 in the hat, I'll break your wrist. I guess I was a little forceful. So I around, I collected $2,400, $100 from each of the 24 golfers. So when the day was over, I called Maggie over. I said, Maggie, you remind me a lot of my grandmother. I don't know how you make a living with two regular customers. She had earlier told me she makes $50 a week. I said, well, how do you feed your children on $50 a week? Well, she says, I have a little vegetable garden. And she says, I grow some corn and some beans. And she says, I trade it with my neighbor. And my neighbor gives me eggs. And once in a while, the other neighbor, he'll slaughter a pig. And we do okay. You know, we get a little pork and a little ham here and there. But she says, we don't want for much. She says, I love my children and I bring them up right. So I said, well, Maggie, I said, this is going to be a day you're never going to forget. I said, this is going to be the day that the Yanks came to town. I says, in an honor of my grandmother who was born here in Ireland, she'd be very proud of me here today. So I says, this is your tip. So I turned the cap up, 24 $100 bills dropped on the bar top. And her eyes watered and she filled up. She says, well, you don't have to do that. I says, I know I don't have to do anything in this life, but I says, you've gone over and above the call of duty. I says, spend it on your kids. I think they could use some new shoes or some clothes for school, right? That was a day that Maggie never forgot. And it's a day that I'll never forget because it was an act of kindness that I received from my little mom, all 5 feet of her. As I continued my pay it forward, I've done a lot of work in the burn community. And sometimes when we visit patients, we never know whether the work that we're doing is of value. Sometimes the patients don't say much. They just look and stare, and look at your scars. But I visited this school teacher by the name of Francine in Boston. She had thrown a log on the fire and a spark jumped out and caught her nightgown on fire. And she was a horrific burn, about 90%. Her face, her neck, her arms, her chest. And she wondered whether she would ever return to school teaching. So I kind of think I did my first re-entry program, Barb, about 28 years ago, but it's not as good as the one you and Amy have done. But I visited her every week, and I encouraged her and said, you know, you'll be okay. The kids will love you. You're a good person. So I never knew whether my visits were worthwhile. She did return to teaching, and she retired to Vermont, and I lost track of Francine. But one Christmas Eve, I was at my brother's for a party, and the phone rang. And I hear my sister-in-law saying, yeah, Jack's brother George is here. And then I hear her say, yeah, he's the guy that was burned in that house fire. And then I hear my sister-in-law say, well, do you know George? Do you know George Pessotti? And the girl on the other end of the line said, she says, yes. She says, that's the man that saved my life. I didn't know that my sister-in-law knew Francine Sabian, the school teacher from Winthrop, Mass. She called in that night to wish my sister-in-law a Merry Christmas. I guess my visits did help. I didn't get the reward until 12 years later on a Christmas Eve call. What is that worth in your life to save another person's life? Can't take it with you, right? We lose track of some of the values and freedoms that we have. I'll never forget another burned patient I visited. This was in the early 1980s. He had come from Vietnam. He was one of the so-called boat people, and the boat had exploded in the harbor, and he was very badly burned. His name was Chan Twang, and he hung onto a log floating in the ocean for 7 days. So he told me his story in broken English, and I said, Chan, why on earth did you hang on for 7 days on that log in so much pain? He looked me straight in the face. He said, I hang on for freedom. I hang on for freedom. See, because there was not a lot of freedom in Vietnam. We can do anything we want in this great land. He hung on for freedom. That was his goal, was to get to America, the land of opportunity. It's another one I never forgot. 2 years ago, I was honored to receive the Alan Breslau Award. To me, it was the highest award that I could have received for the 28 years of work that I've done in the Phoenix Society. As I came back to our table of friends from New England, Michelle, the mother of one of our survivors, Sarah, who some of you have met, she's been here with crutches and wheelchair. And Michelle said to me, she says, you just don't get why you received this award, do you? I said, well, no, I just kind of go about the work that I do. I don't do the work that I do for any awards or trophies. I do it because I love helping people. She says, well, she says, you know, my daughter wouldn't be walking if it wasn't for you. And she went on to tell me how 7 years ago, her daughter was in a house fire in Maine. And her boyfriend and two-year-old son died in the fire. And Sarah was badly burned. She jumped from the third-story window, fracturing both of her legs. And she had burns on top of the compound fractures. I met her at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston. And like the daughter I never had, I immediately fell in love with her and her story. And I was so touched to think that a 19-year-old girl would spend the rest of her life in a wheelchair. And for 3-4 years, she came to the Phoenix dances in the wheelchair, and I had all I could do to hold her because her legs were all twisted under, and if she could walk, she'd walk on her ankles. I said, there's got to be a way to get this girl to walk. So I sent an email to Rob Sheridan, who's chief of burn surgery at Shriners and Mass General in Boston. He's on the Phoenix board. Great man. I said, Rob, I said, it breaks my heart to think that this 19-year-old girl will spend the rest of her life in a wheelchair. She doesn't have any insurance. Is there anything you can do to help? I'll be back in touch. I'll talk to a couple people. Beauty of email. So bring her into burn clinic Tuesday. Rob examined her. He said, I'm going to put her over to an orthopedic surgeon. I think I can get an exemption under Shriner's rules, yada, yada. She went in for surgery. They put rods and pins in her legs. They straightened her lower legs. She had the big screw-in rods. The kid was in a lot of pain. But she left the hospital with a walker, no wheelchair. Then she went to crutches. Now she's thrown away the crutches. She walks on her own. She dances with me at the Phoenix Dance. She just had her first child 3 weeks ago. See, it can change. The value, I didn't do that for any award or any accolades or any trophies. I did it because I wanted to help another human being. And she's well worth the investment of my time. We have to have a lot of faith. My parents were very faithful people. I believe in a lot of things, and I'm not going to be an evangelist, and although some people say I do well starting my own church, but this is not the venue to do that, so we'll keep that lecture for another day. But when I was in the hospital, badly burned, I was running 104 temperature. And my mom and dad visited Father McDonough at Mission Hill Church in Roxbury, Mass. Happens to be Donna Summers' church, which she sang in, so it's a famous church. And my mom explained to Father McDonough that her son had been burned almost 90%. He was running 104 temperature, and they didn't know whether I was going to survive. So as Father McDonough went down the aisle, he sprinkled my mom with some holy water, and she had a religious experience and passed out. An hour later, when my parents came to Brigham and Women's Hospital, my temperature had dropped from 104 to 101. I've never questioned that. I don't know whether it was the hand of God or whether it was the wonderful antibiotics that our medical community has today, but I won't question that. I learned a lot about my body in recovery. I learned that when I was hurting, some message in my mind said, beat faster heart, pump the water, pump the blood to those areas that need healing. Just kind of happens. I became a diabetic because of the amount of sugar that I had, but as I healed, my body corrected the sugar levels. So I don't question that faith, but I know there are a lot of miraculous things that happen in this world. If you were to study each and every person's eyeball under a microscope, there are no two eyeballs that are alike. If you would line up the 6 billion people in the world and have them all reach out with their hands, and you were to study their fingerprints, there is not one fingerprint out of 6 billion that's identical. I think our special creator gave each and every one of us a stamp to make us a little different than the person next to you. And as life goes on and the world expands, we'll have 20 billion people someday, and no two people will have the same fingerprints. So I challenge you to think about that. Think about this wonderful world and all of the blessings that we have here today. Just think about it. I'd like to talk a little bit about maybe some steps to success, or what can you do to help change your life. I'd like to share some things that I've learned over the years. I think that you have to look for your passion in life. Passion is something that's within your heart. Maybe for some of you it's volunteering for the Phoenix Society. I know that's my passion. You are my reason for living. But maybe your passion is working with pets and animals, which my wife loves. Or perhaps it's working with the elderly in a nursing home or at your church, or helping teach disadvantaged children. Whatever it is, look for that passion in your life, because you don't have to rehearse or practice passion. It's within your heart. Look for your passion. We wonder what our purpose is in life, and I remember at One World Burn, it's all right if I take this off, right? Getting worked up now. But Dennis Garden, who was one of my mentors at the Phoenix Society, spoke at a World Burn Congress. And he said, how do we figure out what our purpose is in life? And Dennis went on to tell a story about the guardian angel that pays us all a visit in our mother's womb. And just before we're born, the guardian angel whispers something in our ear. She whispers our purpose in life. We're then born, and we spend the rest of our life trying to figure out what it was that the guardian angel whispered in our ear. We all have a purpose in this life. I hope you'll find yours. Another key to success is to be able to control your thinking. A drunk once said, it's not my drinking that has me stinking, it's my stinking thinking that has me drinking. Now, you can't say that if you've had too much to drink. So don't try to repeat that at the closing ceremonies and the banquet tomorrow night, because you're not going to be able to do it. But trust me, control your thinking. A little bit earlier, before we started, there was a slideshow. I was very happy to go through my archives and put about 200 slides together with music. And if you think of controlling your thinking, your mind is like a camera. If you feed positive thoughts into your mind, you're going to feel positive things. If I look through the slideshow and I see Alan, we've got funny hats, we've got burn survivors, we've got precious moments, we've got World Burn Congresses all over the world. Those are happy events. When I look at those slides, I feel love, I feel passion, I feel elation. Those are the qualities that I feel. And I profess to you that you can control your thinking. It's a process. Just decide which slides you feed into your brain. If you want to feed the slides in of my burned kitchen, or my scars, or a murder, or an accident scene, or a death, or loss of a loved one, feed those slides into your brain and you will feel exactly the opposite. You'll feel depressed, down, despair, out. Dr. Deepak Chopra, I heard him talk in Florida. He says, the human body makes every drug sold at CVS Pharmacy. He says, if you jump in front of a bus every day, and it jams on the brakes and it scares you. Body makes adrenaline. Adrenaline makes heart pump. Not live long. Don't step in front of bus every day, but you can control what you do. He also says if you feed positive thoughts into your mind, it's very relaxing. Look at a sunset. Look at a moon. Think of a pretty moment. Lay in bed. Listen to your heartbeat. Become relaxed and your body creates Valium. Very relaxing. Learn to control your thinking. Because it's not my drinking that has me stinking, it's my stinking thinking that has me drinking. Someone once asked me, they said, gee, you're very tactful. I said, well, I have an acronym and a definition for tact. I says, tact is the ability to have somebody see the lightning and not feel the bolt. So let me tell you how you would be tactful. You know, if you met a woman, it's not what we say, it's how we say it. But if you looked at her and said, you know, every time I look at your face, right? You have a face that would stop a clock. You wouldn't get too far with that comment. But let's just kind of rearrange the words and look the same person in the face and say, you know, every time I look in your eyes, time stands still. Just a little different spin on a face that would stop a clock. or you make time stand still. Same thing. My wife says, if men could only learn to start with the head and work their way down. Valuable advice, men. Work here first. Gee, honey, you look very nice today. Did you have your hair done and your nails done? How was your day? Is everything all right with the kids? Can we sit down, have a glass of wine, and see how your day was? Start here, men. Dude, we have too much testosterone. Also, I say associate with winners. John F. Kennedy was from Massachusetts. He was one of my mentors as a young man growing up in Stowe, Mass. He was from my home state. I remember hearing him say, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. See, he didn't pronounce the I's either. But he was a great man. Today I might rephrase that, say, ask not what the Phoenix Society can do for you, ask what you can do for the Phoenix Society. We need help volunteering, fundraising, donations for Phoenix to expand and complete its mission. We need your help. Coach Ingles in high school was a mentor of mine. He was a 6'5" football coach. We had a little finger that was sprained. He'd say, spit on it, get up, run again, block again. Won't kill you. If you miss the block, run up that hill backwards. You maybe won't miss the block or the tackle next time. Come on, guys, let's go. Suck it up. A quitter never wins and a winner never quits. Come on, boys, let's go. Coach Ingles. Had a school teacher, Miss Lira. When I'd read in front of the class, she said, oh, you're the best student. She says, you read so well, poems and poetry and the tea house of the August moon with Miss Higga Jigga. But those little pats on the back made me feel good as a person. It's a great way to build self-esteem, is to take steps in life, accomplish little things. You'll get pats on the back. That's where the teachers stick a star in the middle of your forehead. It's tough to get them off later, but it makes the kid feel good. It's my son, Stephen, after I get home from the hospital. This is a little boy that said, Dad, when you come home, are you coming home forever? And that memorable night when I had to leave home when the marriage fell apart, as I said my prayers with my son, Stephen, I said, Stephen, Dad's going to love you till the day he dies, but I'm not going to be living here anymore. I have to leave. I have another place to go. But I'm going to come twice a week, every week, and we'll be friends. I'll always be your dad. And this little six-year-old boy looked me straight in the face. He said, but Dad, you told me you were coming home forever. Broke my heart that day. One of the most emotional days of my life and my wife's life was when we attended a wedding in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. This very special friend of mine, who many of you know her story. She's given me permission to talk about it because I'm going to show a little clip so we don't violate any confidentiality issues. But Charlene was in a plane crash. She lost the love of her life. She was almost 100% burned. She suffered in silence for many years, trying to find her way out of the darkness. She finally met a man. They went for coffee, have a drink. They went to dinner. They fell in love. And they married. And I had never met her beautiful, wonderful husband, C.H. But when I attended that wedding that day, I felt I already knew the man. Because any man or any woman that can look beyond the scars and look through your eyes, which are the windows to your soul, and look into those beautiful intrinsic qualities that separate us from other people, I knew that C.H. had fallen in love with a very special woman. So with Charlene's permission, this is about a 1 minute clip. Let's back it up.
Thank you. to share in a marvelous moment as they begin their life together.
Need I say more? You see, there's always somebody out there in life. Charlene here in CH? Stand up, Char. CH? See, life is all about love. CH was able to look beyond the scars. And for those of you suffering in silence that may think you may never have a relationship, I challenge you to think otherwise. There are so many people in this audience that I know, and I could tell you their stories. They have married and fallen in love subsequent to their burn injury. So have hope, renew, recover, and return. Because hope is a great ingredient. Dr. Phil's sister-in-law, Cindy Brodus, wrote a book called Random Act. Has anybody read that book? Few of you have. On her way to the airport, a teenager threw a vial of battery acid off of the bridge and it crashed through the windshield and horribly burned her face. In that book, which I've read twice, she chronicles many of the same feelings that the Phoenix Society has. But the thing that stuck in my mind that Cindy said is, we choose the type of survivor we want to be. If you think you're disabled, you are. Alan Breslau once said to me that the only disability people have is the 6 inches between their ears. I like that. Because if you play the tape, oh me, woe is me, my pity party, nobody will love me, I'm scarred, I'm disfigured, I can't do anything with my life, then guess what? Your brain will listen to those messages and you are disabled. Come to these congresses and refresh and renew. Hopefully we can give you some hope. Dennis Garden once said to me, my burns do not define who I am. I like that. Dennis doing wonderful things in the burn community and for many years for the Phoenix Society. See, because I think if you have a positive attitude in life, if you have a good attitude in life, you'll reach a high altitude in life. Because attitude, in my opinion, equals altitude. You know, we can choose to be sad over what we don't have, or we can rejoice in what we do have. Take inventory. Don't let your scars be your bars. Someone once asked me, how do you measure time? So I don't measure it in days, hours, minutes, and seconds. I measure it in experiences. Because the longer I live, I believe that time is measured by the experiences and relationships that we have. And if you have more experiences and relationships, then I say you have lived longer than me. It is not about years. It is not about years. I think the good Lord, you know why he gave us 2 ears and 1 mouth? Guys, pay attention. He gave us 2 ears and 1 mouth so that we would listen twice as much as we talk. That's a good one. I said before, it's not what lies ahead of us that matters, and it's not what lies behind us that matters. It's what lies within us that matters. Work on those internal, intrinsic qualities. Forget about worrying about life where the sky meets the ocean. It's not the end of the world, it's the beginning of an opportunity. I have an acronym for FEAR. The letters for FEAR stand for false evidence appearing real. When Christopher Columbus looked out at that ocean and he thought that the world was flat, there was a lot of fear because when he set sail, he may never return. But the false evidence was that the world was not flat, it was round. A lot of false evidence. We worry about fear of failure, losing our job, fear of marriage, most of the fears, fear of being late for work. We have no control over whether there's a traffic jam. It's usually false evidence that appears real. Martin Luther King, another one of my mentors, said we should not judge a man by the color of his skin, but by the content of his character. I have a dream today. Martin Luther knew that if you got to know people, it didn't matter what their skin color was. It's what they had to offer on the inside in his famous speech. So I would say, as burn survivors, we should not judge people by the contour of their skin, but by the content of your character. I have a dream today. I have a dream to see the Phoenix Society in every major burn hospital in the country through their SOAR program. I have a dream today to see the reentry program in every school helping children adapt and return to society. Yes, I have a dream today. I have a dream that we'll walk through the valley and see this wonderful organization in every major city where no burn survivor has to suffer in silence. I have a dream today to see the tools and the resources of the Phoenix Society expand. That is my dream. And the work that I do with burn survivors, some of the greatest rewards come from the survivors themselves, but they also come from family members. I met with a family in Boston, and it was a horrific story. It's a case of abuse, burns by abuse. And there are many of you in this audience that have that situation to deal with. So Mike Paganelli, is Pags here? Mike here? There he is. Mike Paganelli was badly burned in a car crash, right? A lot of visual scars on his face. But in my opinion, that man, to me, epitomizes what I consider good attitude to be. Because he has a great attitude despite his burn injuries, okay? Mike and I met with the family. Brought in Sadie Wilcox from Michigan. Beautiful Sadie came in and shared her story with the family. I think it was uplifting and inspiring. And I think we gave that family hope. And I think as they looked through the tunnel, they realized that the light that they saw at the end of the tunnel wasn't the train coming at the family 100 miles an hour. It was the light of hope. We try and deliver that through the work that we do. After that visit, in closing, I received this letter, card, from the mother of the burn survivor. She writes, "Dear George, I just wanted to thank you for meeting with my family yesterday. I cannot tell you what that meant to us, but please know that you're an angel to the rescue. My heart has ached for days with just whispers of hope brought to us. But yesterday, you gave us shouts of what life could be like for my Carmen in the future. I love who you are being and my admiration for you and Mike. Please let him know the lightness in my heart. I will end this, my friend, by telling you I'm glad you were born. Sincerely, Joan Blandon and family." That's the power of hope. On behalf of the Phoenix Society, I want to thank you for listening to me for an hour. Hopefully, I've given you some hope, some perspective on life. Hopefully, I've uplifted and inspired you. Hopefully, now that you're in recovery, you'll be able to return and renew and get back to your families with a new sense of hope. And remember, there is always somebody in this world who will love you despite your scars. So in closing, I will say in French, je t'aime. I love you. Thank you.
Thank you, George.